Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome everybody to the European Center for Clinical Research Training free webinar on ETMF working paperless. My name is Paula Hemdel and I'm your moderator today. During this webinar, we'll go over the requirements for working paperless and how to ensure GCP compliance of digital trial documents, including an overview of the latest European Medicine Agency guidance. I'd like to let you know that this webinar will be recorded and it'll be available later as a free resource on the ECCRT website. You will be muted throughout this webinar, but I'm going to be looking for any questions that you might have in the chat box. So feel free to go ahead and click and write into the chat box and we can go ahead and answer those questions for you. Dr. Marlene Verbeek is the trainer. And she has been a trainer with ECCRT since 2004. She received a PhD in molecular biology from University of Utrecht and has done fundamental scientific research across several international universities. She moved to the clinical research area as a CRA, medical writer, and has performed a lot of clinical research training. More recently, she is specialized as a regulator consultant on European clinical trial legislation. Marlene is passionate about helping to boost confidence and competencies of clinical research professionals such as yourselves who have joined this webinar. And so without further ado, we'll go ahead and have Marlene start her presentation on the ETMF working paperless.
Okay, thank you, Paula. So let's go ahead with this small free webinar. So this is about working paperless, as this is the future, because there are many advantages. This is an interesting webinar, I think, because you'll have to know what are the requirements. These are the three elements we're going to present. Why and where are we speaking about electronic TMFs? What are the GCP requirements and how to do it correctly? What are the correct steps from paper to digital documents? You can think about many advantages which you do not have with paper. With paper, the possible duplications are much harder to detect. You could have multiple and variable isolated systems where you keep documents. The time you spent to consolidate disparate documentation is also much larger when you work on paper than when you work electronically. And of course, when you work on paper, you're much more vulnerable to disasters like fire, flood. When your documents are in the cloud, of course, you could have maybe in the future a digital disaster. But of course, it's already a reduction of the disasters if you work paperless. Furthermore, other advantages of working electronic is you have good quality. You can always read it. It's always legible. You will have access to full information and up-to-date information. The access is easy. You can track easily versions. The management is facilitated by electronic trial master files. It also enables to perform risk-based monitoring. It enables remote work. Your documents are actually in place and immediately inspection ready. It's also easier for archiving. Just like I said, you can avoid some disasters. And finally, it's also an element. There is a reduction of cost, not to speak about the eco-friendliness of using less paper. So where can you work paperless? At the sponsor trial master file for the clinical trials, the source documents in the investigational sites could be electronic, and of course also the investigation site trial master file could also be paperless. The sponsor and the investigator are indeed to retain and to control all documents which are pertaining to the trial. That's a GCP requirement. And this both, as you know, at the sponsor side as well as the investigator side. Now, for an investigator, GCP also says before, during and after the trial, there should be documents. But on top of that, at the investigational side, you have the source documents, and they can also be on paper or digital. And more, we're also talking about the digital electronic health records that even general practitioners have, because more and more, everybody is working electronically. So this is going to be playing a more important role also in the future. You can think about electronic health records, where elements have to be captured into a CRF, for example. In the future, it's going to be much easier to capture from one electronic system to another, of course, provided there are conditions, provided that no names are transferred to the system of the sponsor. But it will save the sites a lot of time not having to copy data into the CRFs for clinical trials. So this accounts for the source records, and for your information, also the European Medicines Agency already issued some comments on what they call direct electronic data capturing. So you should consult also the website of the European Medicines Agency to find some reflections on how to do that correctly. And of course, the site trial master file, which is the trial-specific files, can also be electronic. This electronic system has furthermore the advantage that the patient is a patient. So whenever later on, even after the trial, it's very important to have the easy access to documentation all over of the patient. So it only has advantages actually to work for source and for the trial master file electronically. From the other hand, the sponsor, as you know, is also to establish records before, during and after the trial. That's a GCP requirement again, and that's the sponsor's trial master file. Also for the sponsor, it's easier to have it on a digitalized way. Now, what are the GCP requirements exactly? First of all, GCP says the sponsor and the investigator should have these documents to allow supervision, but also to allow monitoring and to allow verification during audits and inspections. GCP also says that documentation, no matter which medium is used, the GCP is applicable. We do not make any distinction for the requirements of GCP regarding paper or electronic. That's exactly the same. GCP also requires that the sponsor and the investigator have to maintain a record of location of essential documents, including source documents. You see, GCP is already referring also to the electronic source documents. So they say it's paper or electronic, but more and more we're also moving to electronic source documents. So there should be a specification where documents can be found. The storage system used during the trial and for archiving, again, irrespective of the type of media used, so paper or electronic, should, however, provide for documentation identification, version history, search and retrieval. So if you have paper documents, you have the index to help you out to find documents. For example, if you have two versions which were approved from the protocol, the two versions have to be there. So you have to be able to identify them and to find them and to retrieve them. And that's also the case when you work electronic. Furthermore, when you work electronic or on paper, an audit trail is obligatory. Again, whether you work on paper or not, you'll have to know who and when a document was made. Why? Because you'll have to be able to track documents in a secure, computer-generated and time-stamped way of all entries or actions that create, modify or delete records. This allows reconstruction of the course of events. So this is already speaking about the electronic tracking. So also electronically, there should be an indication of time or date, and who made it and or who created or who modified it. This way, indeed, you can reconstruct the trial events. And this way, you can really provide evidence for the integrity of the trial conduct as well as of the trial data. And that's what it's all about when you talk about GCP. So the computerized system also must maintain an audit trail, a data trail, and an edit trail. The Alcoa principle, you know, it's a document has to be attributable. There should be an author. It should be legible. You should be able to read it. It should be contemporaneous. There should be a time or a date indication. It should be original. That's the truth. It should be accurate and it should be complete. Nothing left out. Documents also should be protected against accidental or intentional corruption, deletion, unauthorized changes or manipulation. Indeed, that would jeopardize the integrity of the data. You would not believe the data if there is tampered with, if there is manipulation going on, which is not visible. So that's the audit trail, ensuring exactly that it's into the map, who is doing what and when. You'll have to have also a security system to prevent indeed unauthorized access to the data. Well, it's easy with computerized systems, that's with the passwords and the access levels. And you'll have to maintain a list of individuals who are authorized to make data changes. That's also neatly organizable and programmable in computerized systems. And you have to maintain an adequate backup. In the old days, it was more difficult. Nowadays, now backups are made into the cloud. Does GCP define details about what an electronic authorization entails for a certified copy? Now we're talking about certified copies. I'm going to let you vote for this, and I have to launch the poll. 1 second. And now you should be able to vote. So the question is GCP giving details about what electronic authorization is for a certified copy? So it's 50-50. Actually, it's not detailed. It's only overall that it's clear what is electronic authorization for a certified copy. Because a certified copy is a copy which is certified to be an exact copy of the original, and the certification means it has a signature and a date. And it's by signing that, you say it's the same as the original. But what that means electronically, when you work with electronic documents, it's not really specified. Except that it says that a validated certified copy is needed, and therefore a validated system must be used. So this goes back to the computer system. And actually, that's a good thing, because when you work with the computer systems which are validated, you do not even have to worry about this. If the computer system is validated, the copies will be certified, because automatically you will have the time indication, and through the passwords, you will have the person who is validating them. So validated computer system, just to remind you, it means that the users have different access levels, that there is a clear, unique user ID, identity, and password, that there is an audit trail. We call that the metadata behind the computers. There is data security. It cannot be deleted. Therefore, there should be system backups. The system should be protected. Whenever something is changed in the computerized systems, there is a clear change control and has to be tested on bugs, etc. And there are strict SOPs also, and there should also be a help desk, etc. So there is requirements for the IT people when you use computerized systems, that it has to be a validated system. But once you have it, of course, it eases all the electronic work. Like Paula already announced, the European Medicines Agency issued guidelines. And in December last year, they finally finalized a draft, which was there already from 2016 or 2015 even, for the compliance in relation to the trial master file for paper and or electronic, for the content, for the management, archiving, audit and inspection of clinical trials. Strangely enough, the drafts always became smaller and smaller. So, for example, before the draft, they had specific specifications of the size of the computer, for example, what was needed when an inspector from the European Medicines Agency came for inspection, that it should be at least, you know, the A4 format of a paper sheet. This was deleted in the final version, but that's maybe minor. But there's now a final version. So if you, that gives you good guidance, what they expect. And if you know what the inspection expects, you know what to do. Like I said, there is also now a reflection paper on the expectations for electronic source data. And we are going there more and more because this, it will such be such an ease for the sites to do this. And a lot of doctors already work with tablets, et cetera. So that's really going to be in the near future. And the data transcribed to electronic data collection tools in clinical trials. So the step from the electronic source data to the CRF electronic data, because you have to make them sure indeed that the patients will not be identifiable and that the sponsor has no control of the electronic source data. That is specifically said. The source data is the ownership of the hospitals. So it's not okay that, for example, a sponsor puts up a portal which the sponsor controls for the source data. So that's not allowed. So also the hospitals will have to make an investment for this, their portal, so to speak, and then there should be an in-between to anonymize and code data before it goes to the CRF, the sponsor. So I also strongly advise you to look at these two guidance. Now we go to how to do this. Are there instructions how to do this? How to go from paper to digital. You can have two types, actually. You could have and create an electronic EMF outside an IT environment, simply as documentation scanned or electronically transferred to a centralized repository for PDF images. So you make everything on a PDF. And that's fine too. It's kind of electronic, but it's outside an IT environment. Of course, more you work, more inside an IT environment. It's a complex system as being part of a document management system for the creation. So you also create in that environment, reviewal, modification, and version control of documents. It's more complex because you can do much more with that system. And this is, of course, much more used, although it can integrate also PDFs. What is important that you have to have only one version of the truth. So the electronic TMF should be well organized. There should be security and control. Therefore, there should be a process for filing for the structure and for the index of an electronic TMF. GCP also says whenever you use an electronic system, people have to be trained. So inspectors are going to check if people are trained on electronic systems. So the involved staff has to be trained what and how filing needs to be done. Also, some file naming conventions should be established and adhere, and you have to follow it. The guidance says the aim of the file naming convention should be that even by looking at the name of the file, you know what it is. So the file name clarifies the content without opening it. In the past, I have seen companies where it was hard to let people follow the conventions. People thought they had freedom in applying conventions. But you really have to stick to them, of course, because this will avoid double filing and will be clear cut for everybody, anybody who is involved to find a document. There should also be a role-based, a function-based access levels, so that the right persons have access to the right documents. In some companies, it's really a CTA who has more access levels, and the monitors have to send their documents to the CTA, who then puts it in the right position. Some companies it goes directly, so but there should be different access levels to also be in control that nothing gets deleted. There should also be electronic track change versions, but you have to check also in your company, what is the procedure, what you have to do? Do you have to keep BAFTs? Do you have to keep working documents? Are they to be tracked or not? Are they to be kept or not? So you have to be clear cut on that, because if you have a mixture and then a mixture of the naming, you're also lost. And that's what the inspectors found in the beginning, that people could not retrieve the exact document they wanted to see. Question is, can the paper version be destroyed after digitization? What do you think? You can vote. Okay, thank you for your votes. And you indeed have the correct answer, only under certain conditions. What does that mean? Well, it means, for example, if your original is already in an electronic format, and there are many like that, but it was just printed for working or for reviewing or for just looking at it, you do not have to keep, of course, the paper document, and you don't keep that paper print out. You have it electronic anyway. Documents which do not have a wet ink signature, you can destroy, because you didn't have an original wet ink signature anyway. So that's also logical that you can destroy the document. But even if you scan, sign document, and if it's not a contract or an informed consent form, because that's what the European Medicines Agency still is saying, although in the United States, for example, they are a bit ahead, there is already much more even electronic informed consent forms. But the European Medicines Agency says, well, for contracts and for informed consent forms, where it's original wet signature, which is important, there we do not advise to destroy the paper version yet. So there are some exceptions, and you have to have good procedures when you, for example, digitalize and scan documents. If you don't have good procedures, then an inspector will question the quality and the reliability of your paper versions. It sounds a bit silly, but there should be scanning procedures, meaning that there should also be a quality control about the scans to make sure indeed that you do not leave out headers and footers when they are scanned, that you do not leave out that nothing is written after scanning on such documents. So that is also very strict, because otherwise it would not be reliable again. So there are conditions where it's perfectly allowed and to destroy the paper afterwards. The next question I'm going to ask you. Does every scanned or paper version of a document need an electronic or a wet signature attached to the workflow in order to confirm that it is a certified copy of the paper original? A difference of opinion, so it's again 50-50. But the answer, and that's also according to the European Medicines Agency, is no, you do not have to sign anymore. Of course, provided, again, that you work in a validated system. Because that's their answer. They say, implementing a validated process for scanning, including a systematic quality control check to ensure that the scan is an exact replica of the paper, is critical of the process. So again, you see here, they stress, if you have a good procedure, we do not need this extra work of signing it off, while in the old days we had to do it. So they came already across a little bit saying, okay, we do not need that anymore. So I'm going to give the word back to Paula to see if you had questions.
Yes, hello. Yes, we do have a question. It was actually asking about whether the definition that you had showed earlier is the true definition of validation. So there was a slide that you had showed earlier that said a validated document is, or a system is that the true definition of validation?
No, what I showed, that is the practical implementation already. Mm-hmm. The true definition of a validated computer system is that the computer system is doing exactly for what it has been developed for, and that you cannot have any unauthorized changes or bugs, or so this, the bug is the problem, the computer system has to do what it has been developed for. That's in a short sentence what is validation of computer systems. So, and also that there is indeed no unauthorized manipulation in that system. And that is the, in short, that's in two sentences, what is a validated computer system? If you look at GCP, also if you look at the FDA in the 21 Code of Federal Regulations for where it speaks about validated computer system, it's exactly the same definition. A validated system is a system where the system does exactly, you are controlling the system. The system does exactly, but exactly what you want it to do. So any change has to be tracked. When you have a bug, it has to be deleted. You need to have, so that has a lot of practical implementations. And I showed you the practical implementations, like the passwords, the help desk, the SOPs. That's what it means. I hope that is clear.
Good, thank you.
Okay.
There is one other question. You had mentioned sometimes about the quality of the documents, especially when you're scanning them, and
yeah,
whether or not you can then remove, delete, or destroy the original. What would you do if the quality of the scanned or e-doc isn't good? For example, you saw later that it is missing headers or footers.
Okay. So that is indeed problematic if you already destroyed that document. But these things can happen. It can happen, but the chances that it will happen are smaller if you have an SOP. An SOP that should be, people who do the scanning have to know that SOP. It sounds a bit silly, but I give you examples what should be in that SOP. When they start their scanning job, so to speak, not for each time, but they have to make sure that when they start, that all the pages are present, that all the information is present. Meaning, like you say, Paula, the headers and the footers, you'll have to be vigilant when you do the scanning that it's included, that all true blank pages are removed, that there is not a mixture with blank pages, that the correct size is used. You can think about the US format versus the European A4 format, landscape or portrait, rotated in the same way, for example. The image is too light or too dark. Is all content, including signatures, legible? If you have, but nowadays it's less of a problem because we can scan in color. The sequence of the pages, if there are hole punches, were they there, yes or no? So to demonstrate this is a true digitalized copy. In case what you now say, we have the constatation that for one document or two documents, we miss headers or footers. Mm-hmm. What is my suggestion? My suggestion then is you always have documents related to each other. To find a document which is maybe connected to the document to which you are missing headers and footers, that you can refer to that as a corrective action. You see? So you do what you can do. But if your SOP says that you could destroy the document, and an error, we are human beings, so an error can happen, but it should not happen on a systematic way. And that's why the European Medicines Agency says, when you provide quality for the digitalization process, you'll have to do also an audit once in a while on the scanning. You see? So you try to do the best. You try to have a procedure and also to audit the procedure once in a while. So that's the same with all other SOPs. So you have to follow SOPs. If people do not follow the SOP, there will be sometimes an audit. There could be a deviation, a small deviation, which is, okay, you have human errors, and then you have to correct what you can correct. That's my advice, is look if pay documents connected to that document where you lost the header and the footer, because that's possible that you will have a connection. And that's all you can do if you already destroyed, if your SOP allowed destruction. You cannot do more than you can do. And that's a good question, because that's exactly why you need an SOP and why EMA even says do an audit, even on the scanning.
Mm-hmm. Great. And we have one more question. And the question is, my company is currently a paper TMF approach, but we have shadow files with scanned documents. At the completion of the trial, when my company sends the paper TMF, I don't know what should be the approach for the shadow files. Is there anything? Deletion, archiving?
Well, it depends. Is it a CRO, that company? That's the big distinction.
Yeah, don't know about that.
Maybe the person can quickly...
The person, yeah, can
chat,
add that in
that.
The question.
Because that makes the difference in the answer. Because CROs often have shadow files.
Yes. I think the answer is yes.
Yeah. Okay. It's typical for CROs that they have shadow, so-called shadow files. Now, this is more a practical experience. What I can say is that CROs always keep, although they're not the final responsible person, it depends on the contract also. It should be specified in the contract who is keeping the documents, but as the sponsor is the ultimate responsible party here, always documents go in their completeness to the sponsor. But it doesn't mean that the shadow file is going to the sponsor. The shadow files, we call it shadow files, but actually it's also the TMF with F in it. And what is the practice of many CROs to keep also, even though the project is finished, to keep that shadow file and to digitalize and keep it as a kind of backup. It's not the first time, and that's my experience, that a company for whom the CRO did a clinical trial, 3 years later or 5 years later, are asking documents again because they are going to have an FDA inspection, and the CRO did everything for them, and then at the end of the project, or even in between, send documents to the sponsor. That's still because the sponsor did not really be on top of every filing and every document. They just knew that they received everything, and that sometimes they go back to the CRO to ask for some documents. And that's exactly why many CROs, they keep the so-called shadow file, but they complete it at the end of the project to have also a kind of copy, but not on paper, electronic, in-house. That's a common practice, I would say. But of course, the person said you're working with paper documents.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So it's clear that you'll have to see with the contract with the sponsor. And normally all originals go to the sponsor. And I only can tell that it's common practice in many CROs that they scan everything and they still have a digital copy, but not more, less and less paper copies. And a digital copy just on a DVD or in the cloud, that's done often. That's regular practice. I hope that answered the question. If not, the person can
write something more in the chat or the question. Great. I do know we have one more question here. I think we have time for this one more. The question is, can you please summarize when a signature with the date is still needed? When do you need to certify the copy? And is it only when you don't have the access to the source document?
If even the source documents are electronic, and it's a validated computer system, meaning that the data cannot be tampered with when you have to review it, so they are locked. So you can think about blood values in the computerized system in the hospital, that source document. Then if there is an outprint, you do not need a signature anymore. In the old days, yes, but now if the hospital works with a validated computer system, you do not need a signature again. Okay, then if for the scanning, you can think about, people ask me a delegation list. So they have a delegation list, and you'll have to make a copy for the sponsor's TMF as well, to show that you are also on top, that you know who is doing what in the hospital for your trial. As long as the project is not finished and the trial is not finished, you will collect these copies. And I have seen people that they are validating that copy, but it has already so many signatures with dates on it from the people on site. That is overdoing it. This is not good practice. This is overdoing it also for the site, that you will validate a photocopy of a document with already dates and signatures written down. I hope that clarifies a little bit. So if we're talking about source documents and documents coming from the site, in the old days, we had to have wet signatures, but it comes from an automized system, a computer which is a validated computer system. That's again the requirement. If not, if everybody can access that data, then you need a wet signature. So you can also think about, for example, the doctor writes down when he has a consultation his notes. The notes are scanned and the paper is destroyed. You as a monitor come to monitor. The printout of that scan doesn't need to have a signature by the doctor anymore, because uploaded in a validated system, it cannot be changed anymore. So it's fixed. So then you know this is the truth. It's all about, are you sure that nothing can be changed afterwards? Well, it's not allowed to change. If you write something on paper and you scan it, that's it. You cannot work on a scan document and then say, and then do not rescan it, for example. So it should always be traceable. And if you have that, then you don't need that signatures anymore. I hope that's also enough.
I think that was very clear. Thank you. I think that's all of the questions we have. Before Marlene wraps up, I just wanted to remind everybody that this has been recorded, so it will be put on the ECCRT website under the free resources, and you are free to go to that section of the ECCRT website to see previously recorded webinars as well. So Marlene?
Okay. Yeah, thank you, Paula. So I have some more. Let's see. So here is what would you check to assess the quality of documents digitalized or scanned? I already explained to you, are all the pages present, the numbers of the pages, and the headers. So that should be in a procedure and there should be an audit. If you want to know more, we also have the classroom training with many tips for the CTAs, who are usually responsible for documentation. But we also have the so-called microlearns, which we are going to release in September, which are short sections on what is on electronic TMF management and electronic TMF oversight. And we are constantly expanding these microlearnings. It's also about 15 to 20 minutes that you can select some certain topics which interest you, and they will be explained. So that's, I noted already that in the future, we're going to have a lot of them. So people can really pick what they need to get more insight in what they want to know. If you still have questions later on, you can always email also this campus, but actually it's now info@ECCRT as well. Then it doesn't leave me anything than to thank you for your participation, and wishing you a good afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.